evening. I'm going to do something I normally don't do, and I'm going to record a video for you guys, because one of the most popular search terms for my blog is how to use watercolor markers. And I realized it might be hard for you guys to see what I'm doing using just photos. And I also thought it would be easier to use a video rather than explaining every single step through text. So first I'm going to ink this prepared sketch. It's on Fabriano watercolor paper. I'm going to ink it with a Sailor Mitsuo Aida double-sided brush pen that you can get from jetpens.com if you're interested. The reason I like this brush pen so much is it is both water and Copic proof after you let it dry for 24 hours, which is huge for me because previously I was using India ink for watercolors and Kaime Soul K for Copics and Never the Twain Shall Meet. And this means I can use a brush pen for both. So I'm going to do the inking at a sped up pace, and then I'm going to stop and show you guys how I do watercolors as well. So I hope you enjoy. Before I do anything else with it. So I will see you guys tomorrow. Hey guys, good morning. I'm going to take this moment to cover some of the watercolor markers and brush pens I've covered. That twitching thing in the corner, that's my cat's tail. He insists on being close to me at all times. I'm kind of invading his spot. So anyway, I've covered a lot of brush pens on my blog over the past year, and a lot of watercolor markers, and a lot of watercolor brush pens, and you can check those out at nattosoup.blogspot.com. Under the reviews section, there's like a watercolor brush pen slash marker section underneath the alcohol-based marker reviews. This is in conjunction with my how I use watercolor markers video. Those of you who do read my blog know I do something called field tests now, especially when I actually have enough of the material to do a sufficient test. And since I make watercolor comics, specifically watercolor comics for kids, I like to use my main character, Kara, as the test, because if I can't even render Kara, there's like no way I can use these markers. I occasionally do flowers, but they're not really a big focus for me. It's mostly portrait and figurative art. So that's where I'm concerned. I'm not a card maker. I'm not a scrapbooker. I need more colors than that. Most sets aimed at card makers and scrapbookers don't always have good skin tones. I think that's why Prismacolor and Copic are so popular with them. So it's important for me to find sets that have good skin tones, or something that can work as a good skin tone. And I would like to see a better variety of available skin tones, I'll say that. But that doesn't seem to be a main concern for a lot of companies. So the first I'm going to talk about are the ones that are the most like watercolors, Winsor Newton watercolor markers. And I have a lot of these. I am pretty sure they are pigment-based rather than dye-based. And their marker body is, it looks a lot like the Prismacolor alcohol-based marker body. They may be using the same mold. I'm not saying they're the same brand. I'm just saying sometimes companies, purchase the rights to use certain product molds, even if their products are very different, because it's easier than spending the R&D time to reinvent the wheel. Anyway, these markers are, or watercolor markers, are double-sided. You have a pretty decent large brush and a small bullet nib. I really don't like bullet nibs, so I mostly use, the large brush. And the caps, there we go. The caps are, you guys can't see me struggle, but the caps are tip specific, and they have a little notch to keep them from rolling. Unlike regular watercolors, you're not going to dip them in a well of water to generate your color. That would probably cause a lot of the pigment to bleed out, and some water to come in, and it might ruin your marker. And they work pretty well. Some of the darker colors, like the reds, have a tendency to stain the paper, and they may be harder to blend out. But they're pretty good. And if you want to see everything I thought about them, as well as this field test in progress, again, you should check out my blog. And I have a handy dandy swatch to go with some of the markers I have. I actually recently ordered some more because Dick Blick was having a sale. Sorry, that noise in the background is me picking up the markers as I'm done with them. And I actually still haven't decided which markers I'm going to demonstrate for the test. It's either going to be these or the Zig Art and Graphic Twin, because I really like those too. Okay, so the next marker I'm going to show you is the Marvy LePlume, and I got a bunch open stock from Dick Blick. They're not really my favorite. I don't see a lot of people talking about them. These are also a twin tip marker. It's got these are the only watercolor marker I've ever seen with a fine tip and a pretty decent Japanese style brush tip. And for more information about those, again, you can check out my blog. Then there's the Tombow ABTs, which I actually really, really didn't like, and I know a lot of craft bloggers really like them. I'm going to give them another shot. I tried to handle them the way I would handle watercolors, and I was really displeased. This might be the book that has the swatches. It might not. Yeah. That won't work. Sorry. I'm really bad at this recording thing. Can you tell? This is my swatch book for them. It seemed promising, but I really wasn't that excited about it. I've also tried them with the blender pen, but I'm not excited about that either. So they don't really take layering very well. They tend to remove colors instead of layering them. There we go. So you'll end up with like this weird gray ghosting. So I was not excited about the Tombows. Very disappointing. However, there we go. Zig. Technically Kuratake makes them, but their Zig imprint handles them here. Zig makes the Zig Art and Graphic Twin, which looks a lot like the Tombow ABT, which looks a lot like the Marvy LePlume, which looks a lot like most watercolor markers you're gonna find. But the Art and Graphic Twin handles a lot better than the Tombow ABT, especially if you're an artist, especially if you are interested in doing portraiture or figure work. I like how it handled, I liked how it layered, I liked how it reacted to layering and water. It handles kind of like real watercolor, but not, which I'm okay with. I'm trying to find a swatch for it now. Here we go. Oh, I gotta zoom out. No, not in, out. Yeah, there we go. Yeah. So, as you can see, there's no splitting up of the dye into the individual dyes that make up the color, which is always a big deal to me. I tested the Akashiya Sai markers out, I'm sorry, watercolor brush pens at one point, and that was something I hated about them, especially given how expensive they were at the time. So yeah, I really want markers that have a nice, rubbery, juicy tip that isn't going to tear up my watercolor paper. I wanted to, when I add water, I don't want the pigments, the dyes to split out because I will be adding water. That's just how I paint. Affordable is nice, although I'm not as concerned about things being the absolute cheapest because I do this professionally and I want to be able to rely on my paints. I don't want to have to work around their flaws. But that said, watercolor markers are pretty much always cheaper than the decent alcohol-based markers, and if you're looking to get into using markers, watercolor markers aren't a bad start. And watercolor markers are not exactly the same as water-based markers. Water-based markers, like Crayola, for example, are not meant to be worked in conjunction with water, and it's really, really difficult to get like professional quality results out of them. And I have two more swatches. These were done with the Lyra, with the Lyra Aqua Brush Duo, which is very affordable. It was okay. It wasn't my favorite to test with, but it wasn't bad. If you're just looking to get started and you want to be able to buy a set cheaply online, Lyra is a good way to go. And these were done with the Dewcrafts Artiste watercolor markers, which I thought were going to be abysmal. But they were actually really, really great for what they were and what they cost me. I got them on Amazon. I got the 30-piece set. I think I paid less than $1 per marker, and it comes in this neat trifold easel. And I'm not usually one for gimmicky stuff like that, but I have all these watercolor markers, and I have to buy cases for them and keep them separate because I review them, right? And I want to make sure I'm not getting brands mixed up when I'm reviewing. So I thought it was really cool. And the way they organize the colors is the way I organize colors. So it's like, ah, perfect, pre-sorted for me. So if you have the chance to buy a Dewcraft set, I actually really recommend it. They were really fun to paint with, and they're cheap, and they're good if you're like a high school student or a crafter, or even an artist like me who wants something that's portable, and not all that expensive. And I think I packed them away, so I don't have it to show you, but you should check out my blog, nattosoup.blogspot.com, and search under the reviews for the Dewcrafts watercolor marker review. I think you guys will like it. So, that kind of covered, oh, I should actually do a side-by-side for you guys, since I have them out. Alright, at the top is the Art and Graphic Twin. Then the Winsor Newton, and it will roll if it's double uncapped. But why would you double uncap it unless you're reviewing it like me? And then it's a huge problem, but I usually don't ping brands for that. Let's see, where did I put them? I hope I didn't just shove them in here. I did, I'm bad. A bad, bad girl. All right. And that's the Tombow ABT. Oh, I should uncap the bottom of the zip. And let's see. Aha. Where are you, Marvy? There. I was trying to be neat and tidy, and instead I just got disorganized. And that's the Marvy LePlume. And they're actually a lot more. All right, so I've covered the basics and I've shown you inking. So now we're going to prepare the test piece or the demonstration piece to actually be watercolored with watercolor markers. So for that, you're gonna need your inked piece, an eraser. I prefer white vinyl. This is a Tombow mono eraser from Jet Pens. Some masking tape. Low tack is best. And I like to use a drafting brush to kind of clear away the eraser crumbs. So now the reason you want to wait 24 hours after inking before you erase is because if you don't wait, it will lift up your ink and cause ghosting, especially where you put down the graphite. So you want to make sure the ink is fully dry. Plus, if you're going to apply any sort of media over it, like watercolors or Copic, you don't want the binder or the like shellac or alcohol, you don't want that to be reactivated. And you also want to make sure you get all the pencil. Not so much with watercolor, but if you were doing Copic or Copic and watercolor, the graphite and pencil will ruin your Copics. Your nibs. I mean, the nibs are replaceable, but they're kind of expensive and you don't want to replace them unnecessarily. Especially if you were too lazy to do a good job. Alright, so it looks like most of it's gone. So we brush it off. And then we're gonna use the masking tape to hold it in place. And this white board is gator board, which like political signs are printed on. I just ordered gator board off of like a hardware store on Amazon. But if you can salvage it, you should. And it's not absorbent, and I pretty much always use it for my watercolor boards now. It's lightweight, it's strong, it's not gonna buckle if your paper stretches, it's gonna keep everything where it should be. And this is also, this is not like the proper way to stretch watercolors. It works fine for little bitty things like this, but I think I've done demonstrations on how to properly stretch watercolor paper in the past. Okay, so now my watercolor is secured, so I'm going to make a mini palette for me to apply paints to and mix colors. I could do it directly on the gator board. I don't like doing that because I don't want to cause staining. I'm just kind of weird. You can also use like trash plastic packaging if you'd like. I just don't want to. I think the masking tape works just as well, and it's really easy to apply, and I don't have to wash it off after, which I would do with the trash plastic packaging because I'd want to reuse it for other watercolor marker adventures. I guess I'm just super lazy. And I usually, I don't usually work with watercolor markers all that much right now, just because, like, both Kara and Gizmo Granny don't really call for that kind of a look. And I think they work best with small pieces, so like ATCs or mini watercolors, or if you're into making cards, it would be really good. Okay, so that's my mini palette, and I'm going to take a miniature break and collect my other supplies, and then I'll be right back. Okay, so I mentioned earlier when I was going over different watercolor markers that I hadn't decided yet whether I wanted to use the Zig Art and Twin Graphic Twin for this demonstration or if I wanted to use the Winsor Newton watercolor markers. And I think I'm going to go with the watercolor markers because I recently got a bunch of new ones and I did a swatch, but I haven't done their reference sheet yet. These are for some of my other ones. So I'm going to take this opportunity to show you guys how I like to make a reference sheet. And I think it's really important, especially if you use watercolors on a regular basis and you don't want to have to figure your colors out every time you want to work. So what you need is a piece of watercolor paper. This is a fluid pad. This is not what I'm doing the demonstration on. I like fluid pads. They're fine. I just had a 100 pack of like weirdly sized Fabriano watercolor paper that I wanted to use, so I'm kind of using them for all of my watercolor tests. A cup of clean water, and I have two water cups, a clean one and a dirty one, and I don't ever use drinking cups for my watercolor water cups for two reasons. One, I know people who've accidentally drunk their watercolor water, which is just bad news, and two, watercolors often have like heavy metal as their pigments or colorants, or like cobalt or sometimes mercury, and it can give you cancer. So you, even if you're gonna wash your drinking ware, it doesn't really seem like a good idea to me to use your paint cups as your drinking cups. That's just me though. It's not expensive at all to go buy cups that look entirely different from what you drink out of. This is a Faber-Castell collapsible watercolor cup, and I have two. I have one that says clean and one that says dirty. I'm actually a bad girl because this is the dirty cup, and it's got clean water in it, but I usually am pretty good about keeping them organized. And that's not the sort of cup I would ever reach for if I was just like not really paying attention and drinking. I'm gonna lecture you guys a little bit. I also don't drink out of cups in my studio. I have a self-contained Contigo water bottle because I have a cat and he'll knock things over and he'll steal things. So, I had a friend in graduate school, her inking piece got completely ruined because another friend's cat is kind of a jerk and he stuck his head in her water glass and then knocked it over. And my cat's kind of a jerk too, so I don't really like to leave stuff like that out for him to destroy. I also pick up my watercolor cups when I'm not painting. I like to paint on the floor because I tend to do like several pieces at one time. And I like to have all my junk spread out around me. So like the water is always at Bowie level, and Bowie will drink it and he'll go for watercolor water over like clean, fresh water for him anytime he can. So you really don't want to leave your watercolor water out, because if you wouldn't drink it, you don't really want your cats drinking it, right? I bring this up because I see a lot of people, especially people who are kind of self-taught, practicing really poor studio habits. And I want to do my part to like help you guys out. I mean, heavy metal poisoning, lead poisoning isn't fun. I had a teacher in high school who suffered from it. It's debilitating. I had a teacher in undergrad who was a printmaker by trade, and like the chemicals she used just destroyed her health over the years. So I've seen firsthand how destructive these things can be. Anyway, rant over. So I don't actually normally use this pen, but I'm testing it for the Walmart review I'm working on. It's a big review. It's a Papermate Clearpoint, and it should be just fine because all I want to do is write down the names of the colors I'm using before I swatch them. So that will probably take a little minute. And I've reviewed Winsor Newton watercolor markers before, and I have a running list of which colors are like your best buys in terms of how the color distributes on the paper, how much scrubbing it takes, how true the pigment are on both sides. Another thing. Sometimes with these markers, sometimes with any watercolor markers, one of the sides, usually the bullet nib, is going to be significantly lighter than the other side, the super brush. And that's usually because when they're stored like this. You should never store your markers vertically. I don't care how cute it looks. I don't care if it's got the cute little sticker. I really, just really don't care. You need to store them horizontally so that both ends have equal access to the ink inside so they don't get wrecked. You don't get to complain about wrecked markers if you're storing them improperly. Okay, alright, so here's the thing. So, Dick Blick sent me a dry phthalo blue red shade. Probably dry due to improper storage. I emailed them about it and they sent me another. But look, this is why you should swatch and not trust the color of the barrel. There is a significant printing difference between this one and that one, and they're the same shade, supposed to be the same shade. One of them's the old marker, the other one's the new, and now I've got them mixed up, and I gotta figure it out so I can toss the dry one. Alright, so let's zoom in, and that's what the swatch looks like. And look how nice that cadmium orange hue is. Like, that's my favorite of the bunch. I was really kind of disappointed with this batch of colors, but the cadmium orange hue is really nice. And if you're interested in seeing which markers I thought were great, which ones I thought were okay, and which ones I was like, don't buy, you should read my blog. You should search for Winsor and Newton watercolor markers, and it should come up. Okay, so now we have two swatch/sample pages to reference from. I'm just gonna go ahead and line them up like this and put them to the side where I can see them, but you guys can't because I'm a jerk. And I'm gonna pause the video and I'm gonna switch it back to the palette I had before. But before I do that, I'm just gonna show you guys the brushes I'm using. They're not anything super special. I usually prefer to work with sable. I know that's kind of expensive for some people. You don't have to work with sable, but you might enjoy it more. It might be a more rewarding experience for you. You might get the results you want if you're using sable. I mean, there's different reasons to use different brushes. This is a synthetic. This is, I think it's a squirrel hair, and they rolled. This is definitely a synthetic because it's a Scepter Gold, and this is I'm pretty sure it's a sable. It's a Blick Master, which is like Blick's brand of decent brushes. So I have a bunch of brushes and I cycle them out because if I leave them where my cat can get them, he'll chew on them and that ruins them. You want them to hold a nice point like that with a nice little fat belly. See, when they're wet, that's good. That holds the paint. It is not like acrylic where you want stiff bristles to push the paint around. And synthetics don't have that little fat, soft belly. But that's okay. I mean, it's all what you're looking for. So I'm gonna pause the video and switch things out. I shouldn't have done that clapping sound. I'm sorry. I'm gonna pause the video and switch things out and I'll be right back. So yeah. Okay, so I've laid out all of the colors I think I'm going to need for this particular piece. I might go digging again. I just wanted it to be as quick as possible. So for the skin, I'm using burnt sienna because when you add water, it's a very nice peachy skin tone. If you don't add water, it's a nice suntanny skin tone. I'm using sap green for the background. I'm using pale rose for her dress, and Alice, oh my gosh, I can't even, Elizarin Crimson Hue. Wow, I should be able to say that. For the pink in her lips and her cheeks and her elbows, because it's a very pink red when you add water. Payne's Gray for accents on her dress and probably her hair bow, as well as Burnt Red and Sepia. And this is my character, Kara. She's from my children's comic. The first volume is out, 7-inch Kara. It's about tiny people. It's cute. If you like cute stuff, it's cute. It's for you. It's all watercolor. Because I'm crazy. It was meant to be a webcomic, and then I was like, I'm going to finish the whole thing before I release it. I don't want to just, like, disappear on people, because life gets busy when you're a professional artist slash freelancer. But she's kind of like my go-to when I do these tests. I explained that earlier, so I'm not going to explain it again. Alright, so, for the background, I'm just going to do like kind of a simple wash. That's what I always do with these tests. And I apply some to my side palette. Because with these kind of markers, once you've applied them to the paper itself, it can be really hard to get them to like spread out. Oh, watch. Bowie's prowling around. This is the problem with working on the floor. I'm gonna have to be like, get! Because he'll be all like, hey, I wanna lay on your paper, because that's what it's there for. It's for my amusement. All things in your life are for my amusement. And you just use some clean water to kind of blend it out. And one of the reasons, so something I see a lot of people do on their YouTube tutorials is they don't work with a palette that replicates the color of their paper. And I don't understand why you would use like a hot pink mixing mat, because you can't accurately gauge your color and you're just guessing. And I guess because I do a lot of portraiture and people, it's important to me, but if you're doing flowers, it might not be super duper important to make sure the pink or the yellow you're using is 100% just right, can't be wrong. That's something I would definitely like to work on in the future, is just kind of letting go and relaxing when it comes to this stuff, because I would not say I'm a perfectionist, because I don't think I draw well enough to be a perfectionist. I make way too many mistakes in general, and I'm way too awkward to be a perfectionist, but I am kind of methodical, and I like to do things certain ways, because even though I did go to art school, I am mostly self-taught. Like, the time I spent in art school, they didn't really teach us any real art techniques. It was mostly like, okay, so you should know all this stuff by now. Get to it. Get to making work. So, and my undergrad was just kind of like, we're selling all of our art materials to try and keep the lights on. So, good luck with that. Here is the internet. This is how you Google. Except they didn't even do that. It was basically, use Google. Figure this out on your own. Thank goodness I had a scholarship to undergrad, because that would have been a colossal waste of money. Anyway, okay, so that's the background, and I need to let it dry. And you can tell it's mostly dry when there isn't like a reflective sheen on the paper. And I'm kind of wiggling around because I have natural daylight lamps in my studio, like 4 of them. I told you I'm serious about my colors. So I can kind of tell when the light stops reflecting when they're dry. So I'm gonna let that dry and I will come back to you guys. Okay, so it's mostly dry, and it's dry enough for what I want to do. I just want to apply another layer. So I put some more green down on my side palette, because I had already diluted the other one out a lot, to the point where if I'd applied more, it probably wouldn't be noticeable. And the nice thing about like the masking tape side palette on Gator Board is you can add as much as you want. Or, I mean, I guess you could just use the Gator Board, but I don't really want to do that. And the background isn't really supposed to be anything. It's just to contrast with the pink in her dress and to look summery and cute. and a way to fill up the background so it's not just like, you know, person on white. That's kind of boring. And not that this is super exciting either, but it's more exciting than just like person on plain background. Okay, so I'm gonna let that dry all the way and then I'm gonna start applying skin tones because I'm pretty happy with how that looks. Oh, shoot. You guys can't even see. There you go. Oh, that's so much better. Huzzah! I just wanted to show you guys the palette, but to show you guys the palette, I have to pull out so much you can't even see. So yeah, I'm gonna let that dry. That's really, really important when using watercolor markers, is you let everything dry because colors will have a tendency to bleed into each other. And in unwanted ways, if there's even a little bit of moisture left on the paper. I'm pretty sure these are dye-based, pigment-based, not dye-based, but it's, so it may not be as much of a problem, but it's a really big problem to me, in my opinion, with the dye-based ones, so. Okay, so it's pretty dry to the touch now, so I'm gonna go ahead and apply the skin tone. And as I mentioned before, I just put it on the side palette, and I add a little water, clean water in my brush, and mix it up, and I start applying, and that's kind of where the sables are really nice, because they can hold a lot of your water and color mixture, so you don't have to mix as often, at least I find. So your colors are more consistent. But again, that's only really important if it's important to you, if you care about that. If you get along just fine without it, that's cool too. All right. And you might need to apply color to your side palette often. That's fine. Nothing wrong with that. If you let the water evaporate from your masking tape fully, you can just go ahead and put the same color on top over and over again. You don't really want to add it if there's water on it still, because it will soak up into your nib and it can mess it up. I don't like working that way. It doesn't mean you absolutely can't. Oh, and it's also always handy to have paper towels around. I personally like Viva because it is super absorbent and it doesn't have any sort of a texture to it. And you can get it in plain. It's kind of expensive, but I often reuse the same sheets for watercolor purposes for a really long time. So I feel like it's a really good value for my dollar. And I didn't get paid to say that. That's my honest opinion. That's how I feel. I've been using Viva for like 2 years. I like it. You might not. That's cool. And as soon as the first layer has soaked in, I already start applying the second one. So I pretty much treat watercolor markers for the most part like watercolors. And a lot of that is because watercolor is my medium of choice. I do also like Copics a lot. I just don't get an opportunity to work with them as often. But traditional watercolor with a watercolor look is my jam. Traditional children's illustration, the kind found in Caldecott winning books, that's what I really like. That's what speaks to me the most. So that's what I try to kind of have in my own work. And the thing about watercolor is there's two ways you can apply whites. The preferable way to apply whites is to just leave that part of your paper unpainted. So it's kind of like a natural white that looks really good with the whole image, because all the colors you apply are going to reflect some of that paper. You can also use white gouache, which has a tendency, in my opinion, to be kind of blue. I use it a lot. I mean, it's kind of a crutch. I use it to put in like the shines on eyes, stuff like that, make corrections if I absolutely have to. But I still think the natural white of paper is the best way to do it. I crank them out so quick sometimes it doesn't happen that way. If your paper is still wet as you're applying color, it's going to capillary action is going to pull your pigment across the paper. You guys can see me gesture through shadows, even though you can't see me because we're super pulled in. It's going to pull it across your paper, so even if you had intended to leave an area white, if your paper's too wet, it's not going to stay white. And that's usually my problem, is it's like, I have to put a wash on everything. And as you can see, maybe not, let me zoom in, nitpicky. As you can see, I wasn't careful enough applying the burnt sienna around her ear and her neck because it's bleeding into the sap green. Let me grab some paper towels. If you were quick enough, and I probably waited too long. If you weren't quick enough, you can just like soak. Yeah, I waited too long. You can just soak that up. With watercolor markers, you can't scrub out the way you would scrub out with regular paints. I have found it causes more problems than it's worth to like add water and then use your paper towel and lift it. That would work with normal watercolors. It's not as ideal with watercolor markers. So watercolor markers are kind of like a stopgap. Kind of. I mean, there are people who do beautiful, beautiful things with it, and it certainly can be easier to work with and more immediate than traditional watercolors. You need less water, for example. It's good for on the go, but you can't do all the same things you would do with regular watercolor. Okay, so I'm gonna let this layer, after I apply this, I'm gonna let this dry fully, and then I'm going to apply the skin shadow. And with little demos like this, I often don't really do a lot of shadow detail just because it has a tendency to get muddy really quick. But I like to do it on the skin because that's something for me to take into account. And again, as you can see, you can't see. Okay, as you can see, the skin tone has kind of bled out into the hair. That's not a big deal. All right, so I'll get back to you guys. Okay, so my skin tone is dry, like dry all the way, dry to the touch. So I actually gave it like an hour and a half while I cleared files from this memory card. So I like to use like a red violet or a mauve to apply shadows to like Caucasian skin tones. Because it's a nice contrasting color that is warm enough that it looks like the person has blood flowing through them. And it's a little dark there, but that's okay. I probably could have applied more water when blending it on the side palette. Okay, and then I'm gonna let that fully dry and see if I need to apply any further layers. Sorry. You want to be, let's see if I can pick it up with just the paper towel. No, I can't. So let's see if I can very, very, very carefully reactivate it and lift it up. Might have to do another pass with the sap green. So you can keep layering your skin tones in the shadow for as long as you want, I guess, in order to get as dark a saturation as you're looking for. This one is pretty dark. The more water you add, of course, the less saturated your color is going to be. I don't like applying marker necessarily straight to the paper. Just as I wouldn't necessarily apply tube watercolor straight to the paper. But that's like my personal preference. I've known artists who do, and their work looks great. I'm just not one of them. I always get kitty hairs in my brushes, which is not okay. Kitty hairs do not belong in watercolor brushes. And just like with regular watercolor, if you apply wet into wet, it's gonna have like a softer blend. If you apply wet onto dry, it's gonna have a harder edge, which can be useful for certain shadows. You don't want things to be too blendy. This is kind of blendy. That hard edge denotes different types of light, different light sources, like strong sunlight in the middle of the day, you're gonna have very strong shadows, or like at sunset, you're gonna have very long but kind of blended out shadows. So you don't want everything to be too blendy. And as you can see, there's the purple creeping in on her neckline. So I'm gonna let that dry all the way, and then I'm gonna reevaluate and see if I wanna add more skin tone or more shadow. Okay, so that's dry now, and I think I'm going to go ahead and do a little bitty bit of darker shadow. Because I really want that contrast, or I really want more contrast, I should say. And I maybe go for some harder shadows too. And hard shadows, if you guys don't know, are created when an object, like a head on a neck or bangs over a face, directly block the sunlight. So it creates a hard edge. Okay. And with little bitty, itty bitty projects like this, you really don't need a whole lot. I mean, you only need like one cup of water because it's not going to get dirty enough while you're using it to... Oh, I'll pull out this. Not going to get dirty enough to really necessitate switching it out. Okay. So I'm gonna move this a little bit down, and that's my Alizarin Crimson. I don't know why. I always write it A-L-I, period crim, right? As an abbreviation. So I never actually say it. So yeah. My pronunciation for some things is really bad for someone who should be more professional, right? Alright, so I am gonna start applying the cheek blush and lip blush, etc. And I actually use this color when I apply blush. I use it a orange I really like and a brown to apply blush, but I don't wanna. You can mix these if you want. You can mix them like right there on the masking tape if you want to do that. But I don't really want to when I'm using watercolor markers. I don't want to get too finicky. I know that's ironic considering I literally just told you guys how finicky I am. Her face is really, really like it's darker than I really would have liked. Whine. Anyway, I'm gonna let all this dry and then I'll come back to you. Alright, so, I'm going to try to judiciously show you guys something and I might 100% regret it. We'll find out. So if you really want like the most saturated application of color, you can do direct application. You can do it onto wet paper, which is gonna blend out, or you can do it onto dry paper and then quickly blend it out with your brush. And sometimes you're not as quick as you'd like to be, like me, never as quick as I'd like to be. And it'll give you the most saturated color you're going to get out of the marker. Like that. I really want that purple to be darker, and I don't know if it's gonna be, and I want a harder line on it, and I don't know if that's gonna happen because it's raining outside. And that's another wonderful thing about watercolor, is that if it's raining outside, your paper may not dry out enough for you to pull fine details or pull fine lines, if that's what you're looking to do. But if you're the sort of person who likes to push colors around a lot, then wet weather can be your best friend because it gives you a lot of opportunity to work with the colors in the paper before they dry out and decide they don't want to go anywhere. Okay, so I'm super not that excited about her skin, and I'm kind of super not excited about the shadows I applied. And I have a tendency to like overwork things because it's like, oh, I can fix it. No, I should just learn when to walk away. But that's something I have trouble with because I'm a very, very stubborn person, which can be good. If you're an artist, you have to be stubborn. All right, so that leaves her eyes, her hair, the bow, and the dress, which might actually seem like a lot, but it's not. I also would like to darken up the pink on her cheeks. Maybe I should try the other end, because sometimes, nope, that's even less saturated. Not that you guys can see it. And I store these particular watercolor markers. I will pull out and give everything a little bit of a chance to dry. I store, for the most part, I actually have too many to put in this box now, and I gotta rethink this. But I store my markers in a flat box, horizontally, not vertically. We don't want that, that's bad. I'm gonna be all about that today because I have been watching YouTube videos of people reviewing stuff, which is like my guilty pleasure, kind of, but it also makes me really angry. Because I'm like, no, you're not supposed to do that! But no one can hear me. the joys of working from home. And way too many people store their markers all wrong, and I'm just like, it's no wonder they don't perform the way you want them to. You are ruining them, and you don't even know. And then they're like, oh, and I'm so organized, and it's so cute! And it's like, but those are expensive. So just a little bit of cerulean blue for the eyes. Her eyes are actually brown, but I am coloring the whites of her eyes blue to imply shade, and so it's not like this freaky white patch on her face for no good reason. See, I'm trying to decide whether or not I really want to apply the crimson directly to her face, because I'm not getting as much saturation as I would like, even though I'm like wiping most of the water out of my brush. But you know, I've already got problems with feeling like her face is very, very dark, so I'm not gonna do that.
And once her hair is colored in, because she has dark hair, it's not going to be such a striking contrast with the white of the paper. And see what I mean when I said a good watercolorist reserve the white of the paper for their highlights? I am not as good a watercolorist as I would like to be. Can always strive to improve. I rely on gouache more than I would like, especially considering how it's often just the wrong color. It clashes with the paper. Okay, so I want her dress to be this pinky color. And I'm going to go ahead and just kind of put like a base application of it. So my lightest point is not ever on this dress, would not be the white. The lightest point would always be a shade of pink. And I find it's just easier to work this way than like applying your dark color and then trying to make it darker. When I work with Copics, I always apply like base tones, and then I work from there, and it kind of preps the paper to accept what I'm going to do. And as you can see, now I'm going to have trouble because this green is not going to want to move. All right, so I'm going to let that dry and then I'll come back. Okay, so that first layer is done, and I think I want to show you guys direct application in a larger capacity. So I'm going to zoom in so y'all can see, and hopefully you can hear me. And so the problem with water-based and watercolor markers is it has a tendency to abrade the surface of the paper in a way that alcohol won't. And as you can see, even though these are watercolor markers, this pink does not really want to go anywhere. Let me try something with slightly stiffer bristles and see if I can't bully it into it. But this is why I was like, I've been relying on using that little side palette so much. Because, I mean, it's obvious it's not going to go anywhere. And it's fine for like heavy shadows where you're like, it doesn't really matter, I don't really want it to go anywhere. Wouldn't really be a cute look on a face, in my opinion. I don't really know why the pink is so, why some of these colors are very, very stubborn. They really don't want to move. And some of them are really good about it and will happily oblige you. And you also want to be careful because you don't want to like destroy your paper surface scrubbing, trying to force it into moving. And some colors are better about pigment dispersal than others. Pink is kind of a stubborn one. Lamp black is really good. That cadmium orange hue I swatched for you guys earlier seems like it's gonna be pretty good. Who knows? You only really find out when like you're relying on it to do something and it decides it doesn't want to do it. Okay, so I'm gonna let this fully dry and then I'm going to try and salvage it. Make it look less like an obvious hot mess. All right. Oh, don't want to zoom in. Want to zoom out. Okay. So, the paper is still a little bit damp, but I think it's workable. And as you can see, the pink seems to have faded or lessened it in stark contrast. Or maybe because I have fresh eyes. I don't know. Sometimes it's like a weird combination of several things. All right. So, I'm still going to continue to try and work the color into something more desirable for what I wanted. And I'm going to do that not by directly applying it, but using that side palette I created. And I think that's like really the key to more detailed designs, especially, I don't know. I think I'm always more uptight about something I drew or something a friend of mine drew than I would be about like a stamp
or something. And that could be a bad thing, like maybe I need to just loosen up.
Alright, so that's a little more tolerable. I'm going to let that dry and continue to work it. Okay, so the dress is still in progress, but I think I'm going to start on the hair. And this is one of the few exceptions to the whole don't directly apply, because you're going to have a hard time blending it out. With the hair, you're probably going to want pretty deep color saturation. And it's fine also if, like, you can't get your pigments to, like, blend all that well with, I mean, I think, with hair. Okay, so that's the base layer for Kara's hair. and I'm just going to kind of, soften the line and blend out some of the, and I mean, it's gonna be covered with two layers anyway, so you're not really gonna see it, but I'm gonna soften the edges of the highlight in her hair, which is the white, like we had talked, or like we, like you were replying to me, like I had talked about earlier, with how you want the whitest, your whites to be the white of the paper if you can. And I understand perfectly well, I understand firsthand, if that's just like not a thing you're gonna be able to do. Cause that's hard for me too, and that's where gouache comes in. Also, go ahead and start on her eyes and her eyebrows. And let's see if I can get another layer of the dressing. And even though I'm dipping the brush each time in clean water, I'm also like dabbing it on a paper towel to absorb most of the water from it. Because like I said, I'm using a sable brush. It's got a big belly, so plenty of room for water, which are positives, but like it can also put down too much water. And then you're never actually layering. You're just applying the same very, very, very pale shade over and over again, and there's just no difference. And that can, I found, that kind of thing can make your work start to look muddy, because you have like a million of the same layers, and there's just no variation in what you're putting down. And one of the things I've found that helps prevent pieces from looking muddy, and it's something I'm working on, is like strong contrasts, and not just like contrasting colors like sap green and pink, but also just like a lot of difference in color. So like the purple of the neck would be a contrast with the white of the shoulder, and I wish the face had more of that contrast as well. And it doesn't. Sometimes it's hard to do that on tiny pieces of paper while you're distracted by talking. I mean, this is basically the point where I can work almost nonstop, because there's enough of a difference between the areas, like enough of a physical distance that I can work without the paper becoming oversaturated and everything just bleeds into a mess. I say this, and then that happens, and then I'm just like, well, oh well. I like to do hair, if I can, with three colors, especially for watercolor. If I'm doing Copics, sometimes I'll do even more than that, just because, you know, the paper doesn't start to degrade. But with the watercolor markers, you want to make sure when you're applying subsequent layers directly, the paper is dry, because you can tear up the surface of your paper. Even a good watercolor paper, you can tear up the surface of your paper with the brush, because it's just a little too stiff to work on wet paper. And that's why a lot of crafters complain about their paper pilling with water-based markers. It's because the paper is not fully dry and the surface has already become kind of damaged because the brush is kind of stiff, and it's just like a problem that exacerbates itself. And if you're using good paper, it's less of a problem, but it's still going to be a problem. It's still something you want to take into account. And I'm also sure there are lots of other ways to paint with watercolor markers or to use watercolor markers. And I'm only showing you one way, the way I do for a lot of my tests. And I try to be as consistent as possible. If I'm going to use a different method, I'm going to create a different test. That way my readers and viewers know what I'm, or have an idea of what I'm doing. And hopefully this video will clarify that even further, so you guys know exactly how I'm doing this. And that way, if you want to do it, you can do it too. Hopefully I've made it simple enough and not confusing for you guys. I know I tend to repeat myself. I have short-term memory problems. Sometimes I forget what I say, which is great for like an interactive panel where people can be like, oh, you already talked about that. Not good for a video. Hair is too wet to really go into. Anyway, I'm getting close to being finished. I'm not entirely finished, and if allowed, I will nitpick forever, but I'm gonna pause the video, let this dry out, and then probably finish. All right, so let's finish this up. Well, kind of finish it up. I will probably also do some gouache just to like kind of tighten things up. We'll see. It would be nice if I was getting close. I sure have a whole new respect though for people who like all of their web content is like through videography. Like, that's a lot of work. And as awkward as this is for me, I mean, I'm talking to a camera while painting, I would really like to start doing more of this kind of thing. Oh, all right, okay, hang on. Sorry, cat was like, out, I want out! I would really like to start doing more of this kind of stuff in addition to what I'm already doing on my blog. Although, honestly, the blog itself is already a lot of work, and this is also a lot of work. Oh, now they went back in. I enjoy doing it, but it's not, I wouldn't call it financially rewarding, you know? Doing reviews, the way I do reviews, I don't really make any money right now. So, it would be really cool if that would change. And I'm coloring in her bow with a watered-down Payne's Gray. And Payne's Gray is one of the new watercolors, new Winsor Newton watercolor markers I got. And I've never really, like, put it through any sort of paces, so we'll see. We'll see how well it does. I actually really, really, really like the pink, green, and gray combination. It's one of my favorites. I think it is a very cute color combination without being like too over the top. So, I think I've done a pretty good job of blending out that, like, really stark... Oh, let me zoom in. I'm not out in. I think I've done a good job of blending out... There we go. That really stark contrast right here where I first applied the watercolor marker. And you can do it, you just have to be persistent. Impatient with yourself and with the medium. It's actually looking pretty cute. It's gonna look even cuter. Before it's all said and done. And this sepia is also a new color because when I did the Winsor Newton watercolor marker test, I realized I really, really wanted a sepia. And I mean, I usually have one in my normal watercolor sets. I don't know why I didn't grab one earlier. I usually only can buy like two or three at a time. That's pretty true for any marker or supply, really. Is if they sell it open stock, I will probably buy one every 2 weeks until I have enough. Which is really how I recommend amassing a big collection of any supply. That's how I have all the regular watercolors I have. That's how I have all the Copics I have. I don't really understand why people feel the need to go out and buy the whole thing when you're not even sure if you're gonna need... I mean, it's really tempting, and if that's the only way they sell it, or if that's the only way you can buy enough to even decide if you like a thing, I get it. I mean, I bought the whole Akashiya Sai watercolor set, and I really don't like it. And I was stuck with a kind of expensive, it was a little more expensive then than it is now, it seems to have gone down in price. But I was stuck, am stuck, with a kind of expensive watercolor set with a bunch of colors I don't, I mean, pins, brush pins, watercolor brush pins that don't really perform the way these do, or the way the, Zig Art and Graphic Twins do. They're just not as good. The colors separate out really bad. That's like the kiss of death for me. Like, nope, don't want you anymore. If a purple separates into red and blue and like a magenta, which I understand go into making a purple, but I don't want that to happen. I want, when I add water, I want it to be like a lighter purple. I was really disappointed with those. I had been super looking forward to them. And they were kind of a treat to myself, and they just didn't pan out. Which is why I did these reviews, because I remember when I was a young woman, I didn't really know anything about art supplies at all. I trusted my teachers entirely for their advice, and most of the time it was good advice, but I didn't have personal preferences really until I was preparing to go to graduate school. By that point in time, I'd found jet pens. I don't even remember whose blog. It might have been the Temple of Seven Golden Camels, which is a great blog. I don't read it as much anymore because I'm just super busy. I'd like to. His posts are always really good. You want to, like, sit and chew them over. You can really learn a lot about film, animation, and comic craft from that blog. Or it might have been John Kay's blog a million years ago. He might have mentioned it. But somebody had talked about non-photo blue lead for a mechanical pencil, and I had been using Stadler turquoise lead holder size leads, and I hated them, but I didn't know I hated them until I tried the non-photo blue. And then I was like, oh, I like this so much better. Not that that, but like it, the point was, I only tried it, I only thought to try it because someone else liked it enough to like write a review. And I found that review and I was impressed enough by what they had to say to give it a shot. And like, even for the most part, if I'm gonna buy like a set of something, even if I'm just reviewing it, I usually look into it before I dump a bunch of money. And I had done that with the Akashi Asai, and it seemed like everyone else loved them, and I'm just like the sole dissenter. I really don't like them. Sorry. I like other Akashiya products. They make good stuff, just not those. And that's how I feel about Tombow. Like, they're alright. They make some of their stuff I really, really like. Just not so much the ABTs. And that definitely puts me in the minority, because it seems like everybody who does reviews on these kind of products love them, but I don't hear them mention the Art and Graphic Twin, which I think is the superior marker to the Tombow ABT. Okay, so I thought I was done, and then I was like, nope, let me nitpick forever. So what I would like to do is I want to go back into the background with the sap green. Oh, you can't really. There. No. Sorry. Sap green, and let me see if I can find my gouache. You know, I should probably not make fart noises with my mouth when I'm thinking, because you guys can't see the gesture and you might just think I'm farting a lot. I mean, I don't actually care, but maybe you've got like a 6-year-old who's just like dying of laughter back there. Good. I would have been that 6-year-old. I thought that stuff was super funny. So I'm just gonna try to hide a little bit some of the overages and just make it look more intentional and cute. And see, that's I talk to a lot of people, teenagers, adults, kids at conventions, like a lot, and a lot of them say, oh, I would love to do watercolor, but I can't do watercolor. And there's kind of two reasons you can't do watercolor. One, if you're really good at acrylic, if you're really good at oils, you may think about color application differently, and you may have a harder time doing watercolor. I am terrible at acrylics, and I'm not so great at digital painting either, because I want to like do the 1,000-layer approach, which is how I think about color, is like all these thin, thin glazes, which work well for markers, and they work well for watercolor, but they don't really work well for gouache or acrylics or oils to an extent. I mean, you can do glazes, but like that's literally all I do is glazes. So yeah, if you're, that could be a reason, or it could also be you're just not patient enough. And I'm not a patient person at all. That's like something I really have a lot of trouble with. I've always had a lot of trouble with that. I usually work on 4 to 5 full-size paintings at a time, because as soon as I've put down the paint and I'm waiting for it to dry on one, I can start working on another. And that's how I can afford to do like a watercolor comic and work on a children's book at the same time.
I
Ah, nuts. You see where the green bled into the ear? Alright, well, that can be fixed a couple ways. I think I'm gonna use the gouache to fix it, not try to pull it out, because it doesn't really like doing that. So the cool thing about watercolor markers is you're actually using a lot less water than you might use for regular watercolor. So it tends to dry quicker. And you can kind of plow through it a little faster than you would otherwise. So I'm just using the white gouache to pull in little highlights and details that I wasn't pulling in with the paint. And I don't have a very big set, in my opinion. And considering how inexpensive watercolor markers are open stock, I think Dick Blick has them for like under $3 each. I think they were $2.50 when I bought a bunch of them, because I was like, oh, a sale! And I filled out my collection. But I started out with just a handful, decided that I liked them, and then I bought them every time I went to the store and saw them. And hopefully, Winsor Newton will introduce some new colors. I think there's like 36. I could be wrong. I think there's 36 right now. And I know that some pigments don't translate very well to like the kind of nibs, the kind of markers that the watercolor markers are in. So I don't expect them to bring every color they make. And there's some good choices. I would just like to see some better options in like the darker brown, so I could have a wider variety of skin tones to choose from. Okay, so very last thing is I'm going to do some itty-bitty freckles on Kara's face. And to do that, you want an itty-bitty brush. So let me grab that. This is, there we go. This is a zero by Creative, a size zero round by Creative Rhapsody. Creative Mark Rhapsody. And it's a Jerry's Artarama brand. And they are sable, but they're not as expensive as, say, the Series 7. And I think they perform, in my opinion, I like them better than the Series 7. But for other artists, I think they're a good contender. They tend to be a little bit smaller than the Series 7, like comparable Series 7 sizes. So a zero in Series 7 would be a little bit bigger than this. And the bristles are a little shorter. So if you like a brush with a lot of snap, it's not your brush. But if you're like me and you're kind of heavy-handed and you have trouble controlling it sometimes, it is a great alternative to the Series 7. Which sometimes feels like it's fighting you. Okay. I think I'm going to let that dry, and I think I'm going to do another layer of freckles, and then I'll be done. And that will be my how I use watercolor markers, specifically Winsor Newton Series 7, unless I can think of anything else to show you. And I probably could. I have a lot of art toys. I have a lot of art experience. So it's just like a matter of digging it up and being like, hey, does this interest you guys? And I'm going to say it now because I know I'm going to forget. If you guys have any questions, if you want me to go over anything again or in more detail or elaborate on something, please leave me a comment either on my YouTube channel or on my blog. If this was helpful for you, I would really appreciate it if you liked the video. I'm going to try. It would let me know that you want more of this kind of stuff, so then I could produce more of it, and then you could subscribe, right? I'm going to pause this and dig up some stuff, and I'll be back. Okay, so now that the freckles are dry, I'm going to apply another layer of freckles, and then I'm going to switch to some other stuff that I have to show you guys. And it's going to be a learning experience for both of us because I haven't tested them yet. I bought them to test and I haven't tested them yet. This does not count as a review. It's just me showing you some stuff that should become compatible with watercolor markers. I don't even know how well different brands play together, honestly. I'd like to find out, but it just seems like a review for another lifetime, maybe. It's a lot of work. To do it right, it's a lot of work. Okay. All right, so I'm going to let that fully dry, and that's about done. Like I said, that's how I do watercolor markers. So I have a Tombow. Let me zoom out, actually. An unopened Tombow blending kit. And a water marker, a water pen, water brush pen. Dang, I can't even think today. And I'm going to go grab a Marvy blender. Here I was feeling like all nice and superior. Like, oh, I don't buy multiples of the same thing. Brr, brr, brr. I do. I'm a liar. But I don't like leave them in bags or anything like that. They stay in boxes. They die in boxes. Anyway, apparently I have 3 Tombow colorless blenders and 1 Marvy colorless blender and 1 water brush and a mister that I probably will not use. I've got a different mister that I'm going to use. I'm bad. This one, which I use when I'm stretching watercolor pages because it's the grip is a little easier on my hands. And oh, I know. So I said I wasn't going to use trash plastic as a palette because I was going to want to save it, but here's a piece of trash plastic. So, I guess that means I'm not actually going to use anything straight out of the Tombow pack yet. But, I have seen other posters use a piece of scrap plastic, or clamshell plastic as a palette rather than making a palette. And my problem with that is I want that nice, almost paper white surface so I can get a better idea of what the colors are gonna look like on my actual paper. And if your clear plastic is, it's great actually if you're like on your paper and you're like, oh, that's what it would look like. Then yeah, that could be cool. But unless your surface, like your working table, is the same color as the color of paper you wanna work with, I could see that being very confusing. So, fluid pad, and you know what, let's just try scribbling a little bit onto the palette. Ooh, what a lovely sound. And when I do my side palette, there's always going to be like some paint loss, right? Because like it's masking tape, it's made of paper. So this should have lots more paint to give, and it does. Ooh, that's actually kind of nice. Now I'm gonna be saving scrap plastic just to do this with. And so one of the things I don't really care for with these markers that I do like with the Zig Art and Graphic Twin is that once these have dried, you can't reconstitute the color. So once it's soaked into the paper, it's not moving. With the Art and Graphic Twin, it's very forgiving. You can get it reactivated. This probably means you can't do as many layers as you could with the Winsor Newton watercolors, but you know, I mean, if you're using watercolor markers, are you really gonna be doing a big elaborate piece from start to finish? Like, there are easier ways to get that done, I think. So I just wanted to see if I could make enough to like get decent coverage on a small sheet of paper. I guess I'm just easily amused. I don't know. Anyway, so there's that. Aw, yeah. And I'm a coward because I could be doing it on that, but it's like, nope, nope, nope. That took too long. Let's find, not the phthalo blue red shade.
turquoise. That's good. That looks like it goes with that, kind of. So... Oh, it's like dry erase board sound. And, you know what? No, I don't want to do that. Because it's still kind of wet. So let's use the water brush. And I actually don't really like water brushes a whole lot. Because, they have a tendency, in my experience, to, reactivate prior level layers. But I actually do use them for this faux watercolor technique. I do for watercolor sketches once in a blue moon. I was really into doing it last year, where you use like a Stabilo water-based pen or marker. I was using a Stabilo 88, but I think Stabilo 60-something. It has the bigger tip. The 88 is a fine point. You use a water brush, and you can activate it like it's watercolor, and you can either make a palette on the side, or you can apply the color directly and try to blend it out. I guess that's dry. I feel kind of antsy putting it over something I've just drawn. Let's see. That's my problem. I'm too precious about this stuff. And not in like an appealing way. And you can clean your water brush off on a paper towel. There's going to be some staining on the nylon tip. That's not a big deal. As long as it doesn't leave, drag that color into your work, you're fine. And so, that's like a wet, sopping mess. Let's try like applying some... What color is that? Hooker's Green Dark. Right onto it. That should be fun. And something that's nice about watercolor markers, especially ones that use real pigment, is that you can kind of get more control than like trying to drop paint directly on your paper. I've always had trouble with that. I have some minor hand-eye fine motor coordination skill problems. So I don't like to get too crazy because it turns into a mess. But I mean, these offer you a lot more control than that would. Oh, here's a lemon yellow that I reviewed rather unfavorably. Let's put some of that in. And then I need to do something with the blender marker. Try and blend them out for you guys. I gotta say, I'm kind of impressed with the scrap plastic. I mean, I knew when I first heard about it, I was like, that would work. I don't know. I guess because I have like enough palettes floating around with paint on them. Okay, all right, so I would like to, let me see if I can find my swatch pad is... Oh! Let's try the blender. And then maybe some spray, and we'll see. I forgot how fun it is to just kind of play. When you're doing it on your own dime, there's like... I feel like there's a lot of pressure to like make something out of it. So that it's worth the money you spent. That's not really the best way to go about it. It certainly hampered me from trying new stuff. Okay, so we're gonna use the Tombow blender first and... And it's juicy, it's not dead. That's not exciting. Alright, let's try the also juicy Marvy. I just feel like these things tear up your paper rather than... I mean, they don't work the same way the colorless blender does for Copics or for any other alcohol-based marker. So they're a little disappointing. Alright, let's do some color... No, that's not gonna... Yeah, it is kind of a sunny
let's do some blending with the markers themselves on the paper, even not even on like a side palette or anything. I need like four hands and no shadows. Very saturated when they're straight from the marker. Big surprise. I don't like working that way unless I'm using alcohol-based markers. And you can also use water to kind of push the colors around, which is also nice. Kind of extend the area. So that's cool. Alright, so I feel like that's pretty much everything I've got right now to share with you guys about how I use watercolor markers for illustration. And right now, the way I use watercolor markers for illustration is in a very limited, small way. I'm not fast enough with them to replace my Sakura Koi set, which I use for convention watercolors. Although, maybe at some point, and I think they would be great for, like, field sketching. Although there are a lot of really good field sketching sets out there. I mean, with these, you can slip, like, 6 of them in your purse or your pocket or your messenger bag and be off. And you don't have to worry about pans falling out, I guess, if that's, like, a thing you worry about. I don't. All right, so I hope you guys have a good day. Thank you so much for watching.